news. We will go over Pinckney Street. And they just don't want air conditioning in this room, do they, whenever we're in it?
It's freezing out there and walking here.
Well, I'd rather be cold and put something on than the other way around. Right, folks? All right, so let's see who's here this morning. I'm just guessing off your name. Because I know who you are right now, which is great. So I do want to go over what we did in the last class. We're going to focus on the near time, and I'm going to give you some time as well to further detail your key studies and your major project studies also. So, it's your turn. Let's get ourselves all fresh and into our discussion this morning, folks. So, close the computers, focus your eyes on me, if you will, or at least some semblance of the screen up front. All right, Vitaly, you're on.
So, feds are going to raise interest rates and mortgages twice this year, according to Wall Street.
Why just twice?
The economy is doing well, according to the consumer index.
All right, but what index is that you're referring to? As he opens up his Wall Street Journal, wait, who's going to get there first? Fed readies plan for more tightening. He's reading the top article right now. Right? Is that right? See, you closed your computers, and he's got this old-fashioned print thing right there. Okay. But what do you think is the major reason for them? Because what happened? What index actually crossed a certain line this week for
inflation.
The first time in a while?
Inflation.
Yeah.
Inflation
exceeded 2%. Isn't that interesting? So, of course, whether you believe that what you're buying is at what number? What was that number?
2.1%.
Yeah, there you go. And so, I forget, no one here is above, that I'm looking at is above 35 years old, right? Oh! Okay. Why did I use that number?
That was a 45 number. I'm sure nobody in here is over 45.
No one here is above 40.
What?
Right, so
I
wait,
said 45.
Wait, so it's 2017. That means you were born like in what year?
Higher. 70.
All right. Okay.
46.
Right. Okay. But the reason why I mentioned that is because, of course, back in 1973, 4, 5, inflation was right, when it was this high. But seriously, inflation in those years was double digit at 13, 14, 16.
Yeah, interest rates were, to buy a home, were 17%.
17, 18%.
So look how healthy it was.
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, so once again, context and perspective is really important, as I understand. So while 2% may sound like a really challenging number, I'm thinking, what's 2%? But actually, it's an important number by which you cross a number of indices and variables. So, but that's a real concern. Okay, so you start off the conversation, but that's why there's a concern that Yellen and the rest of the Fed is concerned about whether or not they should tighten the indices. And of course, the administration probably has no interest in seeing that change.
Well, the article also said they were trying to clean up their balance sheets because they had a lot of stimulus type of assets on their books, and that by raising the rates, they're hoping to clear some of that out.
That's a really good point. So how does raising rates clear out those assets?
I don't know if the investors buy them up or if they sell them on the market or they sell them back.
Secondary, tertiary gets pulled, dumped in the primary.
Right, so
because you get now, there's a higher rate.
And didn't the Treasury sell off like $1 billion worth of notes this week or something like that?
So what happens is when interest rates go up, of course, right now people have parked their assets or the money. And when interest rates go up, what's going to happen is people want to reinvest those assets in other either tangibles, not intangibles, which will earn something more than what federal securities or treasury notes or bonds can earn. And what actually happens also is when interest rates go up, that actually pulls money into those securities. And by pulling money out of circulation, it actually dampens the inflation rate. And it also pulls it from the rest of the globe too as well, because interest rates along the globe are very low. Yes.
But the other day, when they actually lowered the rate, when they actually raised the rate, mortgages went down.
They did, so temporarily. And so what's happening is that there isn't a direct correlation between the two. Over the longer term, interest rates will go up. But that was just simply basically a short-term phenomenon as a result. So the two aren't necessarily connected. All right, what else is going on in the world?
I think in the news yesterday, they were talking about Venezuela. They the judicial system basically took the power away from the legislative system. So they're basically consolidating power of their government by taking the power away from Congress.
Anybody
giving it to the
from
courts.
Venezuela?
The what?
Anybody here?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. So
they found a way to centralize all the power.
Right. So what do you think that means for assets and real estate and flight capital? Again, I would think further destabilizes monetary system.
Yeah, things just keep getting worse.
Yeah.
I would think
prices are
wasn't bad enough before.
Yeah. Assets and real estate just gone down to the bottom.
It's already at the bottom.
Just because of that.
That's
well,
right.
They were saying that, I guess, before for the government to enter into binding agreements for like oil type of treaties, they had to go through Congress. Well, now that this has been done, it goes through the Supreme Court, which I guess gets appointed by the president, so it's kind of...
But it's interesting, I thought I read this morning that the Attorney General actually has said, hey, wait a second.
Yes.
So there may be reconsideration.
I mean, it's complicated. If you live in Venezuela, you get a different perspective and different news. If you live overseas, you read the news and
it's all this fake news thing.
You know, they write something different. So it's hard to understand what's really happening. But what they want to do is they want to have all the control.
Of course. But I think the real key to that is, once again, in the Americas, in this hemisphere, it affects capital, movement of assets, and
influence.
Flight capital moves towards, certainly towards South Florida, and that's really had an impact on our real estate. All right, what else?
Did they sign 50 RIDEX? Did they sign that?
Mm-hmm.
Europe?
Yes.
Title 5?
Yeah.
Title 50? Title 50?
You mean the Brexit?
Yeah, I don't know what I'm talking about.
And so, the why, what's the impact? Okay, great. So, you're telling me the story, but tell me the result of it. I mean, it's great to say, here's the news, but what is that going to happen, cause, or what's the impact for that particular story? Or is there any immediate impact?
I'm assuming they're going to start the process of leaving the EU. Which, yeah.
All right, so, you know,
we know
today, next week, next year.
Yeah.
Takes 2 years.
No idea.
Yeah, so, but how long is that?
That?
Is that really going
it's
to happen?
It's already been almost 2 years.
Does it really change the system?
I'm not
sure it is, actually.
I think it's all been accounted for at this point.
Yeah, I think it may be. You may be right. Bigger news, actually. Anybody see what's going on in Russia?
Yeah. I just heard yesterday they did a report that he's worth like $200 billion, something like that.
Cool.
But
what's going on in Russia? Which part? Because I can't watch TV anymore.
Neither can I. But it has nothing to do with Trump and disclosures. But the leading opposition candidate has been arrested again. He sparked demonstrations. Thousands of people were arrested. But what's interesting is usually our State Department puts out a statement that says human rights are being violated. All their offices, by the way, were closed yesterday. And our country usually says this is not what should be happening in Russia. And our country has said...
Can I just say something?
Because, of course, you know, our Secretary of State, and by the way, Putin yesterday said, I've only met Rex Tillerson two or three times, when in fact he's met him over a half dozen times and awarded him the highest honor that a non-citizen could have back in 2013, that medal that was pinned to his chest, because, you know, he only purchased 67 million acres of soil for ExxonMobil's investments. Yes.
I saw the video of the protests. So there were 17 that were approved by the state, and there were hundreds that were not.
That's correct.
And in all reality, you know, it looked like what the United States does. So, you know, if you watch the video and you see kind of how the police are militarized and the way they handle the people and crowd control, honestly, it looks a lot like the United States now does.
But you're watching...
And you still need permits here.
You're watching a video, what they're taking a video of, I mean...
So you're watching RT, Russia Today, or you're watching...
People's stuff.
And so this is the challenge of understanding what actually is happening versus what the impact of what is happening.
Yeah.
It's like watching
our news. It's like, what do you believe? What do you believe?
You see the same tactics, the same formation, the same everything that our police, I guess, use on our citizens here.
So how one manages people in the street is one thing, but whether you have due process of law and whether you
I was just talking about in the street.
I understand. And then whether you have rights and the court system to protect you is another thing.
It's all really perspective, because do we have rights here? I mean, didn't they just change some laws, or Congress pass some internet thing where now ISPs have more abilities to track?
That's right.
Stuff.
So now you can get tracked because the Congress decided to change all that. Good morning, Dan.
I mean, so there's
the same thing, different,
How about other Colombia?
Maybe it's a different thing.
Yeah.
So what impact is this going to have on
real estate? I don't know. That's the next question, of course. Is there any flight capital left from Russia that will have an impact on real estate? I think there is.
Yeah.
It's huge.
Porsche building is probably about 20% Russian money.
Sunny Isles. Porsche, J.E.
Especially now with problems bringing money in, with all the sanctions, they lose the deposits when they come in. And they, according to new law in Russia, they are not allowed. People that are buying, most of them are politicians or working for someone in that campaign, they are not allowed by new law to own anything foreign-based. They cannot have a real estate.
And so this is a way that Putin tries to maintain and keep the capital, unless, of course, you happen to have a way of laundering it through that Cyprus-based bank, which happens to be, and I've forgotten the names of many of these actors because it's hard to pronounce, much less spell. Vitaly Topchenko is an easy name by comparison, really. But there's a case of state actors which creates real problems with regard to capital.
What about Colombia's new study, since we just did a Colombia case study, that millennials now, in this age, I believe it's 17 to 34?
Millennials are a little bit older than that category, but go ahead.
Well, that's what it said.
Mm-hmm. But go ahead.
Okay.
I won't dispute it.
Well, no, it couldn't be 17, so that's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And there was an error in the Colombia case study, which I sent you as well.
We'll discuss that. Yes.
Anyways.
No, it was... So just so you know, of the nine of you that are here, three of you were actively engaged in email discussions with me this past week about the case study, and that was fine. But go ahead. No.
Millennials now want... I want to say it is less equality in terms of male-female roles in the household. So that's been established. In 1994, I think it was 42% wanted stay at home, and in 2014, it was 58. Yeah. So they're saying that it's actually gearing towards...
Men staying home?
No.
So this was a study that looked at male-female roles and how it seems to be that the roles appear to be trending back towards
back
more traditional gender assignments. But what's old is new, and what's new is old again, so I'm not surprised there. Any other news?
I mean,
how about local real estate news and trends? Yes, okay, you first, Luis.
Okay, apartment rents have slowed down very dramatically this first quarter of 2017. And especially on the 28 metropolitan statistical areas in the U.S., and that has worried many landlords around those areas, and they have started to give incentives like free parking or 2 months free, so they can have the buildings occupied for longer times.
All right, and the reason why rents have slowed down is?
Too much supply.
Supply, okay.
Yeah.
And
they're building crazy all
no
over
impact
New England.
And
area.
Demand hasn't changed. You think it's just a supply equation? You think it's too much supply, not less
yeah.
than demand?
Yeah, too much supply, but demand keeps growing little by little, but supply is too much, and
right.
I think that's why it's causing
okay.
that
situation. All right, I think I'll agree, and I'm going to show you a statistic on that. Yes.
Okay. And those articles.
As he's reading his version of the Wall Street Journal, or maybe
I
South Florida
Miami
Journal.
Herald.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Where did it go? I'm just looking at where it is. You know, I figured that everybody's read this and said you're coming in and you're saying, "Oh, gee, what article can Professor Cohen tell me about this morning?" Okay.
No, I found it yesterday. So it talks about affordable housing. Affordable housing trust fund set up by the Florida state legislature. This year, there was supposed to be $1.3 billion allocated to provide affordable housing. The legislators, including the governor, allocated what was supposed to be 1.3 made it to like 200 million instead.
And so, where did the rest of the money go to?
Various tax cuts and to other general revenue funds.
All right, and these affordable housing funds, what are they generally used for?
To provide leverage for private homeowners as a subsidiary.
So are they independent funds? Because I'm not familiar with them. Or they actually go to developers, and are they bond funds for new construction? Or is it just simply to help with purchases and acquisition of housing for individuals?
It's not acquisition. It's more providing a subsidiary for current private homeowners who are landlords to provide like subsidiary for low-income housing.
You mean a subsidy?
Yes.
Okay.
I was going to say, they like the Sadowski Family Fund, here,
yes.
You're familiar with them?
No, not
okay.
at all.
So it's a huge fund. I think it might be one of the biggest in Florida. But they actually give money to developers in addition to, you know, other subsidies that you would receive.
So it's to create affordable housing units.
To actually develop them. So Hopper's got a bunch of micro units going on Sistrunk and Andrews. On Northwest Sport, there's another one that the Sadowski Fund was in. It's actually a Harvard lady that, help settle that up.
Great, I need to know more about that because we're developing micro units in San Francisco and I'd be interested in doing that here. We're working right now on an $81 million project in the Tenderloin in San Francisco. One of our equity partners actually is in town.
That's a funny name out there.
Tenderloin, it's just a funny name.
Well, how many people have been here
in the context?
How many of you have been to San Francisco?
Yeah.
Okay. And so the Tenderloin is so named because it was a part of town which
Tenderloin? Butcher shop?
Was seedy and was an area of ill repute.
Yeah, it's pretty sketchy.
There were some male day walkers.
And female and every other thing in between. Okay. But now it's an area that has seen a rebirth. A lot of technology companies have located there because, relatively speaking, the rents for office and residential are lower than other areas of San Francisco. Twitter is based there, a number of companies. And so our partners have acquired an L-shaped lot, and we're raising the funds. And it depends how much, if anybody wants to invest, that's just fine, see me later. But it's an $81 million deal. We're building 231 micro units. The average size of those units is 253 square feet.
Wow.
How many beds and the beds?
You can probably fit like a double.
That's like a bedroom with a closet.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And I can put up some pictures of the operating memorandum on there.
I feel like if that's gonna succeed anywhere at that size, California is where it will. I think down here we still have a huge transit issue and
what do you do for the bathrooms?
Are there bathrooms in these?
Use your sink.
In the hallway?
Share bathrooms.
So the units have, the units actually have full bathrooms. They do have kitchens. And the reason why I mentioned that, and just I want to hear about Mr. Dowski, I'll talk to you because I'm happy to figure out how to take that model here. We actually are using a modular system to help manage our costs because, of course, rents in San Francisco, which are running about $6 to $7 a square foot per month. So this makes this relatively affordable. So all you have to do is
$1,400 affordable.
Oh yeah, rents are simple there, man. Yeah.
So the unit price is going to be around $350,000.
So the cost of building is astronomically high.
Yeah.
And so all you have to do is take 81
or,
million.
Is that because of seismic or?
Yeah.
No.
It's just.
It's just expensive to build over.
No, this is to rent.
These
we
are
buy things.
Rentals. That's correct. We don't want to sell them. But when you think about it, so Ben, as you mentioned, gee, are there bathrooms? Yes. Are there kitchens? An exit strategy in a property like this is that effectively, and by the way, yes, millennials would certainly be a target market for this, is that you have to make sure you have amenities which can allow people to to get out of that 253 square feet. How many square feet do we have in here? Let's see, one.
More than that.
A lot more. Yeah.
We can just count the tiles and figure that out.
25 square feet.
Yeah, this is 625 or 650 square feet.
So it'll be three of them in here.
So it can be like three and a half?
Yeah, 2.5 of those units are in here. But there are windows, by the way. Each apartment does have a window.
You say, you said windows, and then I
no, there's a window, perhaps.
How many windows?
A window. In fact, one of our likely investors did ask that question.
How do you use a window in every window when they're 200 square feet? I mean, you've got to have
Units
in the middle.
That would internal patio.
So, so every apartment, of course, has a window. But the reason why I'm mentioning that is that, to your point, is that, in fact, one of the exit strategies and for a building, every time when you build a product like this, you want to make sure that there's an opportunity to look beyond just a particular use. And so the exit strategy for this property would be
a hotel.
That's right. So if it doesn't quite work one way, you can work it another way.
Do you have to rezone it to make it a hotel, or you can choose?
No, it's in a mixed-use zone that allows that kind of use for the facility. So it could be an extended stay hotel or a transient facility for just overnight stay. Yes.
No permits.
I was reading in the Roadville, there was a project in New York on Billionaire's Road that was personally guaranteed by Donald Trump, and I found that interesting.
I find it hard to believe that Donald Trump is actually personally guaranteed it.
Well, I mean, that's what the article said. I don't know.
Well, right. there was an article in the paper that Donald Trump personally guaranteed some loans with Deutsche Bank.
Yeah,
it's a Silver family.
In excess of $200 million, that they're trying to find a way to get rid of that conflict because obviously that's a foreign, you know.
Yes,
so
and the emoluments clause forbids that from
and
being in place.
One more off-topic thing, some Mexican company put in a bid to buy Florida East Coast.
Yes, they did. Oh, yeah. Some Mexican
which
company.
Which kind of ties into the Bright Line, I guess, project we're going to go tour, or?
Yeah, that.
All aboard Florida, whatever.
Mexican company, wow.
$2.1
billion. That's right. So,
to buy the parent company, but, you know, obviously the subsidiary is the people.
That's right.
And what's the Mexican company? Modelo?
Modelo Especial.
Mexican, yeah, save money now.
Neighbor Modelo.
Please. All right, so that's a good bit of news to have for the morning. So so we talked a little bit, so I'm going to give you just the, once again, looking at the calendar. All these other things were happening, and you touched briefly on some of these items, but no one mentioned that, of course, the GDP for the quarter was released, and that was part of the reason, as you mentioned, because it's also interesting, gross domestic product was favorable, a little bit above 2%, and that's a good growth rate, but it's not a great growth rate, and so real growth still is a little bit above 2%. And the GDP price index, not the CPI, which is what has worried the Federal Reserve Board, is actually a little bit less. And so that's an interesting factor. So the overall economic growth is less than the consumer price index, but for the first time, CPI has exceeded GDP price index, which is interesting for a change. And so this is now, it has been around 2%, so the gross domestic price change has actually been a little bit less. Personal incomes, people still continue to see that their income changes and it's positive. So that's one reason why consumer confidence is up. Disposable income continues to be positive. These are important, why? Because people who are selling houses, like yourself, still should be able to be selling houses right now, and that's important. Jobless claims still continue to be down. I'm just looking at all these figures, and you look at it, and consumer confidence is way above what the economists thought it would be. So I'm just putting this together as a narrative and story, folks. And so you can do that too. And so if you're out there going to investors, selling the real estate, even if it's doing it locally, then you can put that narrative together for your investors or your consumers and clients as well. And look at this line. So let's see. I guess when, as soon as we had the election, consumer confidence went up. So that says something. So I don't know if that's caused
the Trump effect.
Pardon?
Yeah. The Trump effect.
Yes. And so what's real interesting, though, is so what other index has gone up? What's the major index that's gone up because of what we'll call a Trump effect?
Stock market.
Right. Now, but has the economy actually changed because of this, the Trump effect? No. It continues to go up gently, but there's been no actual change in that. So I just find that interesting. International trade, in fact, our balance of trade continues to be negative, even more so. So I know Mr. Trump is really hot to trot on that, but nothing he's done has done anything to deal with that. And there's something else, which is different than existing home sales, different than new home sales, different than new home starts. It's something called the pending home sales index. So it's not an actual indicator, but it falls in the category of, now that you've memorized everything.
Lag sales?
What?
Huh. I'm waking him up this morning.
Wake up.
Well, remember, we have three different kinds of indicators, right?
Yes.
Lagging.
You're in the spot now.
Leading.
You are.
Leading and.
Continental.
So what category would this be in? Don't say anything.
Pending home sales, that should be leading.
Thank you. Good. He's awake now.
Leading.
Right. So remember what the Case-Shiller index is, and this was released this week. Does everybody remember what it is?
It's just a little test, that's all.
So what does Case-Shiller measure?
It measures the house
over time.
Sell the house over time.
What house?
The same house.
The same house. That's really important. Remember, it is the best indicator of anything when it comes to actual house indicators.
What happens if the house gets destroyed?
It measures the same house. That's
what?
Right.
If the house gets destroyed, it's raised to the ground.
Then what? What do you think happens?
They have enough.
They pick out the house?
They have enough that
right.
There's...
Yes, no, but this is a great point. For the camera, one of our classmates is laughing. But the truth is that basically, but then another classmate says that you have a large enough index, so it falls out and you replace it with another indicator.
Any of these, you'll have a standard deviation.
That's
correct. From there,
thank you. When was the last time you took your statistics class?
High school.
Okay, thank you. Could you remember something? And so, yes. And so the good news is interesting that it's up. So on a month-to-month basis, it's actually up. And that's just 0.9%, which is very strong.
So that means identical home sales?
This home sale.
Okay, single-family homes or all the residential?
So this is based on single-family homes.
Okay.
And what you can see is the seasonally adjusted, which is this chart I think is really interesting, that you can see what happens with sales cycles in the United States.
What are these cities, do you know?
The 20 cities?
Yeah, are they all
off the
major?
Top of the head, I don't know. But I'm sure you could, don't have that memorized. Ben, you're welcome to look that up.
Do you have to pay for a condo day?
Pardon?
Do you have to pay for a condo day?
No.
No. In fact, all of you, I'm giving you that link, like each time you go on to the website and you can look at all of these stats, but I can see that most of you still have yet to do so.
I just looked it up.
But these are there for the taking. And it's just good data so you can see it. But so certainly on a yearly basis, it's rather consistent. We're still a little bit above 5%. But this way you can track sales. So anybody who looks at this and say, wait a second, what's going on here? You don't have to go ballistic from the fact that you don't see any real change. But something which I think is even more valuable and just got updated yesterday is the Wall Street Journal's housing market tracker. And I don't recall if I showed this to some of you actually in the last class. I think I did two classes ago, maybe Jason, you may recall. And so this is a great link, and I'm gonna go to it. We'll see if my index works. And it takes the data that I just showed you and compiles it together in the charts. And here I'm just gonna show you a few graphs, and we can go to the link and look at it. And it looks at these top markets, and you can see the difference. So this is the chart back in 2015 of what's going on with multifamily and single family. And do me the honor, Charles, just dim the lights so we can better see them. Remember the relationship between multifamily and single family? And you can see, let's go back to just before the bubble burst. And so here we were close to a total of 2 million housing starts. And look at the difference between multifamily, REE. Basically, it's been somewhat consistent. We'll say about 300,000 or 400,000. And look at single family, huge supply. And then, of course, it collapsed. Right? And so here, and then you can look at this basically on a quarterly basis, single family, and look at the change, the relative change that's going on. So that was up to 2015, the same data. So the recession there, you can see what collapsed. And so now you can see how multifamily become much more an important role in the overall sales, because here is 1 million total for single family, but multifamily becomes 30-40% of it. Starts cratered at the end of last year, and now this is the most recent. And look, we're multifamily, so now this goes to what Luis was mentioning, right? We're talking about supply, and that's where the rent issue comes in. Remember you just mentioned that there is free rent and other giveaways? Because look what's happening in a couple of quarters here where there's been a big supply of multifamily.
Except for South Florida.
But I believe that, I mean,
it's a special market.
Because the multifamily rents have increased that way, that's why the demand.
Well,
the interest rate's low, the demand for single family is going to skyrocket due to the exacerbated.
So define skyrocket.
Well, for example, in Broward, we're talking like, well, I think it was 9.8 last year over year.
Okay, and so we've got to be careful about how that shifts demand from one sector to another, and which market segment, what price segment, what demographic. And so look here, it's interesting. So we have to look at cause and effect. So this happened because rents went up, so builders said, I can build more. And so at some point in that economic cycle, I'm not putting that up there, remember, we'll get to a peak, so rents will go down because of the oversupply, and people will say, well, maybe I still want to rent there, and people will say, well, maybe I don't have an incentive to buy because rents are softening. And so maybe the demand for single family homes may not be robust just because of that. There are other factors, because of increased income, stability, consumer confidence, that may shift you from that rental to a single family. So it's not directly one-on-one.
Well, this,
have to
this
look
says
at
multi-family.
Issues. And say that again?
This says multi-family.
This
doesn't
multi-family.
Say rental.
Right. Well, so multifamily here generally tends to mean rental. So I'm interpolating it just a little
okay,
bit here.
Because we're looking solely at single family, then
right.
That's completely eliminating condo, co-op.
So there's no question there's overlap. But historically, by definition, single family starts have generally been for sale market, right, folks? And multifamily have generally been rental, but with the exception of some markets. So of course, if you go to New York City or to San Francisco or maybe a little bit in Miami, think about it though. If you look at Miami and you just take the statistics, most starts are still single family, but our eyes are focused on what's tall and visible. And so we've got to be careful about what it is that we're dealing with here. So let's just take a look here, and hopefully I can click onto that. And I wonder if I'm going to get that link to work. Yes, okay, maybe we can. Okay, so this is, we're live now with this. And here, you know, you can literally see for each of those years, you can tell you the relationship between those markets and tell you the change in each of them. So this is a great link to look at that. And then the same thing, we'll look at existing home sales versus new home sales. So you can just not only go to the EconoDay website, but now the Wall Street Journal, but they only update it like every quarter. Mm-hmm. That's why I like looking at the weekly EconoDay or the figures. But here, this graphically helps you look at things over a period of time. And I think that's really valuable as well. And then here we have Case-Shiller. And these are the indices that I was just talking about. And you may or may not recall, so here you can choose different cities. So let us just go back. We'll choose
LA, all over the place.
So let's just choose Miami, New York, and San Francisco.
What color is Miami?
Purple.
Yeah, so let's see. Miami is the purple number, San Francisco is yellow, and New York is green. And the dotted line is just the US average here. And so with Miami being the purple, you can see that it really went up in 07, went down, and then now it's going back up. San Francisco is still leading the pack.
Miami was really overpriced.
So by the way, so now these are the 20 cities that Case-Shiller does follow, if you wanted to know. So I didn't have them memorized, but that's your summary right there. So it's interesting that they follow those particular markets, and that's where they're able to get enough data to look at the
Is that the only reason they follow those markets, is because they can get enough data?
I don't know. I think there's a combination of
I'm curious, Tampa.
Can you click Detroit?
Say what?
Can you click Detroit?
And what would you like me to click on?
You click on the right-hand side as a city.
Yeah, no, it's live for, you know, so, I mean, if you want to just see what's going on in Las Vegas. Right.
No, Detroit. He said Detroit.
One up.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, that's kind of what I figured.
How about Tampa?
So Tampa has not done that well. I mean, it's a little bit less than Miami. Washington, D.C. has done really well.
Can you include Atlanta?
It's not done as well.
Wow.
And if you look at Cleveland, it's down below. It's really interesting. L.A. is really pretty high.
All over the place.
Miami's sort of heated again.
So Miami, once again, went really high, dropped to the national average. So it's just a good way to look at relative performance from a lot of different markets. San Diego, once again, would be high. San Francisco, Seattle. So they all seem to be tracking very closely to national averages.
And how often is this updated?
Pardon?
How often is this updated?
I've seen that they update this about every quarter. But you have to check back. It's just that I noticed when I was going online yesterday, they did it last night. So, and so then they not only do the Case-Shiller index, they look at the supply. And so this really tells you again that certainly just before the recession, we were and we were at about 6 months, and then went up to a 14-month supply, and now we've been bouncing around between a 4 to 6 month supply, which seems to be normal.
They say 6 is equilibrium, or 5.5 is equilibrium.
Yeah, that's about right, about standard. So when the numbers go out of the range, you know, something's out of sync. So that's just, once again, when you see these numbers and this information, it gives you the clue as to what's going on for all this information. Okay, Charles, if you can put the lights back on, that would be great. So I thought this was interesting. No one mentioned this because we've been talking about what's going on. Remember the Las Olas View project that a lot of you worked on? So Coulter has just announced that they just broke ground for this new deal just down the street. Anybody aware of that?
Yeah, I was there.
So it's going to have the high eccentric and bottom part of the hotel right there of the building. So whether they'll get those prices or not, it's kind of be interesting. They're the only new condo downtown. All the others are rental product. So I find it interesting and surprising that they're doing it, but culture seems to have an interest in doing condos. But I would,
do they have
it'd be interesting to see if they convert to rental.
Do they have anything planned for downtown West Palm, Coulter?
Well, they're building 333 right now. It'd be across the Alexander Loss. So it's called the Alexander.
It's just called the Alexander.
Okay, that's the
first. Right, right. Remember, so the building they originally were going to, it was going to be a condo and it's going to be called ISIS. But when ISIS came to, yeah, great
yeah.
name choice.
Well, that's like that TV show Archer used to have.
And that is condo?
Called ISIS. And then
yeah, yeah, that's right.
No
and so that building should be finished actually in 2 months and will be the next new apartment building that come online.
So it's not condos.
It's not going to be condos.
Okay.
They abandoned the condos.
Okay.
Condos, I don't think, are working in West Palm right now.
Okay. They also bought the land off of Donald Ross. Coulter, right? Don't they have like over 1,000 units planned?
On Donald Ross?
Yep.
Oh, you're talking about
just
the
south.
The Brigger Trail, 95 and Donald Ross.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, they bought all
that. Yeah, I thought that was that.
Yeah, that's Alton.
What's that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's already way underway.
Oh, yeah.
Those are homes that are going from the fives
yeah.
up to a million and
change. Oh, I can tell you, so a guy who focused on luxury product, all the aqua products down there, who was originally from Canada, I'm drawing a blank right now, not Newland, anyways, he's now left the luxury product, and he's developing, it was in the Real Deal yesterday, assisted living and with an affordable component, also a memory care, and it's going to be right downtown. And it's, I think,
which downtown?
Broward. Yeah.
So,
Lake Broward Boulevard area.
It'd be interesting to see how you can do assisted and memory care.
That's what he specialized in Canada.
I don't know how you get subsidies for that product.
It has like three components,
yeah,
which I thought was interesting.
Really challenging, because there are no programs that I know of that can do that right now. So that's one deal, which I thought was interesting in the news. The other I thought, Mario, you would be knowledgeable what was going on in Brickell. This was in the Real Deal. I didn't put on my list at all the products.
Yeah, I know, I just read the article actually.
That's
I'm
right.
Building up Brickell, yeah.
Right, but you know, we can go through what's going on, and of course the top is really, Swire has I don't know when they're actually going to start. They're going to build their 1,049-foot tower just adjacent to
their trust building.
Yeah,
right across from 600 Brickell.
Right, and it's right on Brickell Avenue. And I just did a tour actually with my University of Miami class on Monday night of Brickell City Center. I mean, I've been there a couple times now with ULI, and of course they're going to extend the ribbon right to the edge of Brickell Avenue. Have any of you been to Brickell City Center?
Yeah.
Yes. So, do you think the ribbon works?
What ribbon? I haven't seen it.
The climate ribbon.
The climate?
The
so the concept behind Brickell City Center
yeah.
is an outdoor retail environment.
Yeah, outdoor
is that
mixed
the climate
use.
Ribbon helps to modulate the temperature of the retail environment, and that they've used the fins, if you will, to guide the prevailing winds to help. Manage, I don't use the word.
I didn't even notice that.
it's hard to notice, man. Or it's hard not to notice it. It's pretty big. It's just, it's there.
It's
but it's seamlessly tied in to everything.
It's $1 billion. It's hard not to manage it.
LEED, right? That's a
LEED
certified building, right?
Yeah. I think so. Yes.
So I pulled up the article because you asked kind of about how they were going to do it. It's kind of interesting.
I got to
look at this.
Yeah.
It's actually like a mixed use for elderly people.
Where is that?
How do you define elderly? Okay.
We're going to say AARP members.
You don't probably have current reverse mortgages.
I mean, that's
okay.
401 units.
Forward that to me.
Yeah.
Okay, that'll be interesting. Okay. So, but there's hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars of activity. And so what this indicates to me is a continuing shift, even though we know that there's Miami Center, which we're gonna go see next week, and there's Miami World Center to the north. But most of you, I think, would see that, and we can question, because we're gonna have Chad. How many of you know Chad Maxey? Some of you do know him. Okay, he's gonna be our first speaker next week, and then we're gonna have the development associate speak to us as we go down there. But the shift in the downtown to this side is a real interesting question as to where the focal point in the ground zero is.
Well, they're doing a pretty big streetscape project in downtown Flagler. They're trying to,
yes, they are.
I guess, bring that up. There's a lot of money going in there, so
yes,
there's maybe some opportunity there.
Maybe, yes, there are. So the question is, you know, when they build that 1049. And then there are the two towers. So they're trying to get that underway. And then I forget the names of the developers who are doing the two towers. They're calling it the towers by Foster and Partners. And those are right at the end of.
Are those the largest buildings?
That's right.
Yeah, that's a pretty tall building there.
They're very tall. I have that information right here. Well, of course, once again, I thought Marielle would have all that information.
There's a building under construction.
Because you're selling, because she's selling all those units, right?
She was working on the case study all week. Okay?
She's at Miami Beach, but that's not really Miami Beach.
No, well, I figured that you would have some.
I've had a lot of the construction tours.
They're actually building somewhere in South Florida. I'm not sure which building, but the tallest building in the southeast, south of New York,
yeah,
is being built in downtown Miami right now.
Yeah, and past the FAA, so I just thought it was interesting. Okay, so let's talk about Pinckney Street.
Did anyone talk about this last week? Oh, look at our grades.
All right.
Ugh, it's all getting bad news.
just ruined my morning.
No, I think it's important to review what we've done.
Where'd you get the meal? A minus.
Oh. So, for some of you, this is your first case study, and some of you are probably saying, oh, why did I do so well? Why did I not do so well at all? And so I want to go through this and talk about, I know your heads are now buried with my comments, I do read your case studies, because I want to make sure that you think about what's going on. Oh wait, so I guess gave them out. Close them for a second. Just close them for a second. Look at me. All right. So
I'll have to talk to you about this.
No negotiation.
We'll
talk
to
you.
We'll
talk to you. Yeah? Okay. All right. But wait. So the reason why, I mean, I read this, the reason why I am making you write, and of course, I sent you a really great case study from one of my former students, who did just a fabulous job, actually, and you looked at it. You all looked at the excellent example, right? And it's a template, and of course he went above and beyond what had to be done. It was a he, sorry. All right, and if anybody noticed, did you look at the financials? Anybody did? What did you notice about the financials?
They were pretty concise.
Yes. They were detailed too as well. Notice anything else? Anything else that was unusual about them? If you're really looking carefully?
I don't know.
Which financials?
Which ones?
How about the example? For the sample.
Where's that sample?
Provided.
They refer
the
to a table.
Where's that sample? Cash flow analysis.
Or, yeah, Buckle.
Yeah, no, so I was just talking about Pinckney Street. No, seriously.
I know, it does.
So I'm not expecting that everybody do the kind of detail that, you know, John Q. student did.
Can I see it?
And
yeah, I thought this tool was kind of good.
I said good. You did a very good job.
You
said excellent.
Yeah.
But it's not an A. You don't get an excellent unless it's an A.
So, you know, that good?
I think you wrote that on everybody's last page. No.
It's just a
positive review.
So the whole idea is I want everybody to be good at everything. I want you to be multidisciplinary. And so some of you excelled at doing numbers, some of you excelled at writing, some of you didn't excel at anything. And so if I nitpicked and said, you didn't put commas in, you didn't use the right tense, for a lot of you, you didn't write well, that's a big deal, really. And we're just doing a course here, okay? And it's just one case study.
Can I just say, the only thing you criticized, and you did it twice, was my word self-perform. Why?
Did I criticize it?
Twice.
No, it's a great word.
Yeah, you circled it here.
Yeah, I circled it. That was not
that's
a key word.
That's just
why I'm highlighting it.
Well, you said
thank you.
It's amazed that you're used of self-performance.
So everything, if I noticed, it was really, and I'm happy to sit and talk with any of you about anything, seriously. And so the issue here is I want you to be concise in an important way. I don't want you to repeat back the information that you got from anything. And so it's easy for us to read or to review what we learned. So, you know, here we got this case study. And so for some of you, you actually did the background and current situation in like two brief paragraphs, and it was great. I got it. And others of you did like a litany. It's like, okay, but no, I want you to convert that into a summary. And that will help you to think more clearly about what you do. Two or three of you got it, the rest of you, not quite. All right? And then the next is about your findings and conclusions. And I'm gonna go through this recap about all these issues. And that was, okay, it's not just about what you learn, but how you translate that information. So some of you were all about what were the issues, and you didn't deal with the numbers or the equation at all. Some of you, in fact, one of you, and I'll say it actually, who isn't here, he did a great job on the numbers and ignored totally the other issues. Well, that can't be. If there are qualitative issues, you've got to mirror them to the quantitative and vice versa. All right? And so, you know, part of the issue thing is really interesting. Remember I told you about how I met up with Jay Jacobson, who is the contract holder and who is, I think, successfully buying Los Alamos View. And he made a really good point when he said, look, whenever he made a presentation to buy a deal, they would have a team that they put together, just like you have your teams together for your presentations on Pompano Beach. All of you have strengths in different areas. So one of you may know the numbers better, one of you may understand the SWOT analysis, one of you may understand the market, but I want you all to understand the vocabulary and the part of the deal that you are all engaged in. Because frankly, what if one of you is in a traffic accident that morning or gets hit by the bus, so to speak? I mean, because in real life, so for example, you laugh, Noah, but the point is that I know when I've gone up in front of the investment committees and one of my cadre's partners, colleagues is not there. In fact, this happened at our firm this past week. We had three of our team members were interviewed for a big deal at Facebook. You know, we made the short list for a project management deal at Facebook. One of our guys was unable to show up. That's okay, because the other two were totally, completely versed in what needed to be said and done. That's really important. And so I know when all of you have been up here, like you're handing off, but the truth is, so these case studies are the opportunity to make sure you're well versed in each of the disciplines. And I'm trying to get that across here. So nobody got an A. Some of you got an A minus. Most of you got the Bs and the B minuses. But okay, because I wanted to push you, and that's why I gave you this other case study where you didn't have to write everything, but you can see how this student who has a really good name that I'll never forget, but I won't tell you his name, who, yeah, he's from South Africa, actually. And just one of my students, some of you are from Venezuela, some of you are from Sweden, some of you are from the US, this guy happened to have been from South Africa, and really got it. And so the issue here is when you see my comments, you know, I do checks, I do circles, it's just on an alert that you're looking at different concepts, that's great. And I'm happy, as I said, to sit and look at those things. And so what I wanted you, and if you have questions about it, we can talk about it. So I'm focused on your process, what the project is, the financing, the panorama of issues, and the players. And if you can address that in each of your deals, and we'll talk about that too with the New York Times deal, then you're going to be better at looking at every single real estate deal.
So what if we all...
Go ahead, by all means.
What if we're all weak at one area in the group?
What if we're all weak in one area?
I'm going to figure out how to...
Then you're going to just have to learn to be better at that one area.
Then we'll send you a lot of emails.
Okay. And that's part of learning in this course. Now, but, you know, so... you know, when I created your teams, I tried to do my best to balance what it is.
Well, my weakest area is the one they said they couldn't do.
So, it's the discovery, isn't it?
Starting to question your analysis here. Of groups.
So,
the finance? The finance?
So, we're going to look at what's in the case studies. You know, the case studies, every case study that we're doing, there is no one right answer. You're going to learn that there's no, and you know, 1 + 1 still equals 2, guys and gals. But when it comes to what's the right way to do something, what's the right approach, there are different ways to do it. That's why it was really interesting. By and large, when it came to your recommendations and conclusions, I was pleased that what you said, but I wanted to know how you got there. That's just as important.
Inspiration.
Well, it's not just about that inspiration, because you want to know how you got the support for that. And so when some of you say, well, you know, my investment rate was 7%, I said, yeah, but you didn't support it. And yeah, I know where it came from, but you didn't state it. Or if in your case study, you all of a sudden start talking about PMMs and DTIs, well, actually, define the term, and then use it.
I just want to clarify, it is defined, but...
I understand that, but this is...
So your purchase money mortgage, but I should have put next to it PMM.
Yeah, that's right. You should.
Yeah. But it is defined.
I'm being very particular about it, so that you don't get tripped up by someone who says, what is that? Because we have a lot of people who are ill-informed or uninformed, okay? And so, this way, you don't get into that trap where someone questions and checks your credibility at the door. Because I've been there. Right now, as I think I've told you, I'm working with one of my clients, and this is an ongoing thing. This is our project in Arkansas. We're going through the final stages. I thought our loan was going to close yesterday.
You thought that last
week. That's what I thought of last week. And it still hasn't. We've got the big conference on Monday at 2 p.m. and I hope we close this coming week. And you know, it's an issue, and you're looking at different terms and everything like that. And it's all about, are we getting our docs right? Did we define the terms? There are communication issues. If you get it right here, it will lessen your chances for problems. So that's why I want to go through these issues. Yes.
Can I get a chance to resend you the second case study, because I think I did the same mistakes.
Sure.
Okay.
Okay.
Do we have until Monday to send it again?
I'm going to look at what you've done.
Okay.
If you want to redo it on your time and nickel, go right ahead.
Okay.
I'm still going to look at what you did first, because time and deadlines are important.
Because you mentioned I didn't use the right format, but I think I did the right format.
No, I don't think so. I don't see background in this situation.
No, background, findings, and
recommendations. Oh, okay, so.
And recommendations are next.
Do I always have to have those same?
Yeah.
Those three? Okay.
That's the standard I set for the course. Now, somebody else may do it differently, but that's no different than if you have an RFP or an RFQ and the agency, the authority, the private sector people say, we need it this way, and if it's not that way, it's the highway.
Okay, I'll do it again and send it to you Sunday or Monday morning.
That's fine. I mean, when you make your submittal for your firm, and when Orange County says, I want the information on that new hotel site, and if you don't do it the right way, they're going to say resubmit.
Yeah, true.
It's a, you know, there are no shades of gray here. It's black and white. It's no fun. But if you get it right, it's a better chance of getting approved. And so part of the challenge with Pinckney Street was looking at the steps involved. And this time it was a small scale deal. But by the way, it's the same thing with a big scale deal, folks, right? So if I put these things up, and once again, this will come up and you'll see it on Blackboard, then use this as a template for how you'd analyze any deal. So I'm trying to give you a roadmap of how you'd approach these items. And I'm sure some of you felt, and we haven't even gotten there, did you think the New York Times case study was hard?
Yeah.
Yes.
It was confusing.
It was challenging.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say hard, but it was challenging.
Challenging.
It was very
challenging. We're going to try to figure out what made it challenging, okay?
Time consuming.
Yeah.
Time consuming.
Yeah, we have another project, the big one, that we actually is like 30% of the rate. If we have one like this every week.
Oh, we do have one like this every week.
Postpone.
Yeah, because we're going to look bad. I mean, that's just the way it's going to happen.
Life is time consuming. You've got to figure out how to make the different parts of it work to your advantage, okay? And allocate
properly.
Yeah, I took
2 days off.
I'm not here to trick you, to cause problems or issues. I'm trying to give you guidance and a framework to work it the best possible way.
It is what it is.
No, it's not is what it is, but you're going to try to manage it in the best way, make it work to your advantage, okay? All right, so look, you've got to look at the steps. Here, the issue was small scale, all right? And for us, this particular project, okay, we've looked, there was strong demand, of course, so, you know, some of you didn't even talk about what the demand was and the location. Yeah, you all mentioned location, but it's important to definitely determine the whys and the wherefores. So in this particular case, I'm just talking about market, site, physical locations, and because of these issues, I want to make sure you address them. See, the fact that you just even address it gets you past that particular marker or goal line, and some of you didn't even touch them. So brevity, for its own sake, doesn't get you anywhere. So some of you give a very short case study, and it's like, just because you gave me a recommendation, that's not good enough. Others of you, it was too long. And I felt like I'm in the weeds. And that's not marijuana, it was just lots of junk weeds. That was good.
Thank you.
Yeah, very good. Okay, so, all right, so once again, address the issues, and that way your investor, client, or whomever it is, knows that you're knowledgeable about this information. So actually, most of you did touch on the issue of the financing, so that wasn't really the concern because it was front and center, oh gee, and a number of you did say, gee, he should have gotten out and gotten other bids. Of course, you didn't say how many or why, only that we didn't like what we had. And of course, what I call the panorama, and these are the other issues. I'm trying to put it all into a box. What are the other issues that are unique to this particular deal and to any other deal? And that's why, as I said, we're going to get into this on the New York Times. What is it that made the New York Times deal so challenging? What makes this deal or any deal so challenging? And so you've got to pick out that particular issue or item. And if you do, then you've hit that sweet spot or some, if you will, unique issue that demonstrates once again to either your client, your investor, or whoever it is that you're working this deal for, your professor, that you understand the issue at hand. And so, was it the regulatory process here, the historic district, neighborhoods changing? Some of you picked up on some, but it's nice to know if you pick up on all of that. Be truthful. And then, of course, for me, the players. And so, you started. Some of you started, but here, I think the biggest issue really was about leave. And we had a discussion when we were at Pompano Beach last week. What was really interesting, and Marielle, you missed it. It was a good discussion, actually. You vocalized this really well, but you didn't write about it really well. So if you had the opportunity to present and sit, that's great. But then if you were in a situation where, once again, you're only being judged by your written product, you missed out. And you don't have to mention your wife and her and whatever, but yes, and some of you really got it and said it concisely about, yes, can he devote the time? And for those of you who said, you really need to hire another partner, or you should venture in with a contractor who could be someone who could really do the job, excellent. Good suggestion. So a good property, but a poor fit. And so it was interesting. Let me just take the poll again. So this class was really interesting. Most of my classes say, do the deal, but. In this class, let me get the show of hands. Most of you said, don't do the deal. Who said don't do the deal? One, two, I thought it was four or five of you, actually.
Yeah, no, I said, don't do the deal, but.
But.
If you're adamant,
no,
do
but
this.
See, that's
your
the thing. Said,
very,
yes,
like,
see,
low.
You said, don't do the deal, but. Most people say, do the deal,
so
but.
It
and that's a different perspective.
Reevaluated based on the actual demand in the marketplace, which you highlighted.
Okay.
The way everybody was talking last week, I thought everybody was saying not to do the deal. I thought that was crazy.
That's right. No, that's right, Charles. Because when we were sitting there, a lot of people said, don't do the deal.
I said, that's the deal.
Well, no, as the numbers stand, if he paid the $1 million, don't do the deal.
No, don't do the deal.
But mine said that because it's a tight market supply, there's competition, they usually go close to the
he can't do the
deal.
He can't do the deal alone. And from everything you read, he doesn't want to pay for a contractor. He wants to do everything himself. So my recommendation would be don't do the deal.
Do it,
but if he's adamant,
okay,
bring
if
it up.
He gets that $700,000.
So I'm going to get.
I'm going to get very focused.
So how you categorize what you said is important. So given the current situation and circumstances, your recommendation is not to do the deal. However, if you do A, B, C, then you'd recommend to move forward. But that's very different than saying, I'd do the deal if you make the different changes. And I think you've got to be really careful about that, because investors and others will listen, because yes, that's what I heard from last week. It was most of you said, nah, this guy just shouldn't be in this deal, and here's why. And that was my takeaway. And so when I read this because I heard, and I said, most of you are saying don't do the deal, but you know, if you made a few changes. And so that was interesting. But had I never heard that, I might have then read something differently. And so I just want to make sure that everybody understands that very different dynamic from a verbal and presentation format, which is different than the written here. So, you know, we're going to go through this differently. And so that's why, you know, everybody gets up with this major case study with Pompano Beach. So you've got a real client. Now, whether they ever touch, take, or do anything that you'd recommend, we don't know. But they're real, and it's an opportunity for you to have a say or influence some direction of what may happen. So I want you to think about, because here at the school, I mean, Dr. Fred and I are basically saying, it's an opportunity for the class to give guidance, because they need some third party, because they've got too much craziness on their own. And you heard it from Emily. last week, yes.
So just to get clarification, you're saying in a situation like this, it's better to say, I would do the deal if we do this, this, and this, as opposed to saying, I won't do the deal because of this, this,
no, I'm just saying, I heard one thing, and it was written differently.
Well, no, I don't know, and I'm asking, so how would you articulate that if you're pitching it to, you know, whomever, to, because you want to do the deal, right?
Well,
isn't that always the case?
I don't know. Most of you said, hey, you just said to me,
I don't want
yeah,
to
we should do the deal. But only if.
If it's
this
a crap,
an important distinction.
So,
so by the way, my motivation as a developer usually is, I want to do the deal if I can make it work. That's very different than saying, I don't want to do the deal unless I can make it work.
Right, so that's what I'm saying. Okay, so I can
so
answer my question.
I'm in the business of trying to do deals. So if you're in the business of trying to do deals, figure out how to make it work and tell me the hows, the whys, the wherefores. That's an important, and it's not just semantic, difference. Because I want to make you be the guys and gals who are out there, or people here that, oh, you want to do the deal. The investor, your client, your customer knows that you are on their team and want to get it done, but you're smart enough to know the risk, the challenges, and the rewards. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a small but important difference. And you'll get chosen over the person who says, I don't know about it, but I can help you do it. I'd rather you say, I can do it, but here's what we have to do to make it get done and done well. If that's your only takeaway, I'd be thrilled.
Thank you.
Yeah. And then remember, you gotta figure out who does it and which part and how you do it, and that's that whole team. And so, Noah, to speak to your issue here, you know, a good developer or leader of a team has a little bit of knowledge, dangerously so, about all these issues. But you gotta speak to it well, and the better developers can talk their way through just about everything, okay? I know we kind of smile a little bit about it, but it's important to be able to do so. And then make sure you got in your back, hip, or whatever pocket that support that gets you there. And that goes back to, you know, and you probably look at these little comments like, he's asking, I mean, it's obvious. No, it isn't obvious. And by the way, some of you, you stuck a spreadsheet onto your case study. I would never have known that you had a spreadsheet because you made no reference to the numbers. I was thrilled to see there were numbers there. But then, so what? If you don't make reference, or you just have like a number here, then at least you said, oh, see it, but you don't integrate that into the narrative. How do I know that it's important, other than that you just proved to me that you can run a number? So, along those same lines, you know, I kind of repeat this stuff in all my classes again. So, like, this is, you know, this is for Mr. Lee, but it's no doubt it's the same for you. It's the same even for Mary Ann Gilmartin. She's not a new developer, but at, you know, Forest City Ratner or any of the big company, you gotta be prepared. And this is what Mr. Lee, he didn't really understand this. Or did he? But if you pick up on this, you as developers will get it, right? And you have to analyze it. So these are, they kind of obvious, but they're not so obvious if you're in the thick of the deal and you don't remember them, right? And so I don't have to read them for you, but you can see, you've got to analyze things. You've got to do, in some cases, you've got to do the soils and all that. And you've got to research the market. You have to be aware of the regulatory process. So all I'm doing is just putting this up. I'll put it on Blackboard, and you have to be prepared to engage your team. That's what this is about, with the regulatory process. And with the markets, you've got to understand how to do it, make sure you've got the right person there. So yes, your team here in the class, you've got to be, you know, super knowledgeable. But when you get out in the real world, make sure you've got the right people on the team there with you. And not all of you are going to understand the design and construction, but you've got to understand the imperfections. We've got one or two more case studies that are going to deal particularly with this. Acquisition and development financing, his problem was figuring out how to cobble the right financing together, right? And yes, you know, first money mortgage, kids offering, you have some creative solutions to how to get there. And he couldn't get permanent financing on this, but it's so interesting. You may remember the problem in the first development class. People forget how permanent financing can really be a huge help. And you, what you've learned in your financing class, a lot of people don't really understand your acquisition, your improvements, and they don't roll everything into one. And I've done so many deals where people forget, oh, my basis in the deal is the total value of the deal, and I can still get a commitment for the entire deal. Once I've completed it, let me get a forward commitment, even while I get my construction lending out there, and you put the two together. And so, in fact, what did Lee do? Was he getting a commitment for the whole nine yards? No. Could he have done that? Could someone have suggested? Yeah. Could he have looked at the finished value of the deal?
Yeah.
Maybe, that's right. And maybe
to
someone could have suggested maybe there was another newer or appraised value based upon what he put together, and that could have pulled him through the deal, yeah?
I was going to say that 203K allows you to do that financing.
And yeah, I don't even know if it was sufficient.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, they send the appraisers out projected post, and you'll get financed.
Yeah, but the 203 has a limit.
Not yet, but for multifamily that fits because there's adjustments per market debt, per market rate. Remember the other ones were 2 million? The other multifamily they said were around 2 million, right?
Yeah, they did. And so some of you said, oh, but you know, if I do it as a condo, I can sell it. But you didn't really tell me the why, is it? And if you connected the dots, because an investor really would say, if you're sitting there making a presentation,
how do I know
I can get there?
The data was given in the study. That was the suggestion by the
attorney. Okay, all right. But now, so let's just run the numbers, you know, do our own mental back of the envelope. If you looked at the cash flow and you applied the cap rates here and said, all right, folks, I can get to what value in the deal? But some of you said, oh, but if it's a condo, I can sell it out for $2 million at $500,000. What's the actual implied cap rate based upon that? Whole lot less than that 7 or 8%. So then how do I support that? So nobody took it to that next step. And that's what we'd be needing to secure that permanent financing. Now, we didn't ask you to do that in this, but I'm just saying that in your doing any of your deals, you want to take it to that next step. If you think ahead, you can, which then in turn allows you to figure out how you can secure the right kind of equity capital on that basis. So here we are. Once again, we're doing our micro unit deal. We have HFF, Holiday Pinocchio Fowler, who's out there running, you know, finding, and of course, we're helping them to do their job. I'm saying that for the camera again. Whenever we hire brokers, equity sources, capital, we generally tend to have to help them do it as well. And they say, well, how much are we looking for? And so our offering memorandum says, oh, 11 million, 12, 13, 14, you know, we'll take 18, we'll take 20 million, you know. Oh, well, what size do you want? Well, we'll take the small investor, the big investor, we'll put it all together. Got to be flexible. But if you got the numbers right, then you can figure out how to put that together and who can provide the right kind of equity. And then, of course, once again, I keep picking on Noah here, you've got to know all of these items. And if you don't know it, then you've got to be knowledgeable enough to deal with it.
I got that for number one.
Pardon?
Four. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
That's 10.
So those are the activities. That's not the development process, remember.
I banned myself.
Not the development process, those are the activities within. Then, if you want all the players, come on, you fit up there somewhere. Most of you want to be that first item, right? No, what do you want to be, Ben?
I want to be a builder.
A builder. How do you define
a builder? A general contractor, maybe dabble in development and investment.
Okay.
Where is that?
Building contractor.
Building contractor.
There you go. Okay, that's fine. You can be any number of these, and some of you right now are these. Some of you may end up just being the equity of the partners in the deal. Some of you may just be the market folks who are smart about understanding and analyzing the deal. That's fine. By the way, just so you know, okay, I'm the developer. But just so you know, I'm the developer.
Right.
You know, I never know if he's the wise guy because he is the wise guy or because he's finding something cool there to make him the wise guy. No.
I actually just got something which is interesting.
Okay.
It's a Coldwell Banker commercial sending out a survey, and they're then going to populate that data based on where the office market is going on an email blast that they send out to everybody.
Right, at 9:30 on Saturday morning.
Sure, it's automatically generated.
How many things have you been? Just got a new CEO.
Professor Korn.
Yes.
How many things have you been in from that disk?
So what? You know, it's really interesting. So what am I, and have I been? Okay.
Oh.
Private sector developer, public-private partner. I'm an architect. I've done landscape architecture and land planning. I'm an urban designer at the same time. I've been the building contractor when I needed to be. No, not this, not this. I tell these people what to do. Yeah, we'll stay away from all this, stay away from all that. Market research, absolutely. I've been a lender because we had to take our money. Definitely the partner. Yes, I've done the appraisal work, even though I'm not an MAI, because they're just made as instructed. I tell the attorneys what to do, so that qualifies me, right? Yes, I'm certainly a real estate broker. Do public relations and marketing, because our firm has done that, certainly in the brokerage and in the auction side. And I've been an end user. So
what
you can do a lot of these different things. Pardon?
What have you been an end user in your product?
So my firm has occupied the space.
Oh, okay.
Tens of thousands of square feet. So your own product, okay? So you know, as a real estate professional, you can be in all parts of the business.
Yeah, but I mean, okay. You just said you were an architect and a landscape architect.
I'm a licensed architect.
But were you performing? I mean, the work of an architect, a design team, and with the drawings and the construction documents. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
What
did you do as an appraiser?
Pardon?
What? When you said that you were an appraiser, or
so,
that you were that you did the job when I was
so in the Weitzman Group, who are appraisers, market consultants, and advisors, we actually performed appraisals for companies like Mr. Trump's and others to get certain deals done and get advisory assignments financed.
They were part of the group.
Yes, that's right. But I'm not a licensed appraiser.
Right.
I was part of a team that did that work
for
them. Yeah.
I understand for academic reasons, the real estate development process follows step by step. And
yes, it does.
But I've seen in real life, because I've worked
real life folks
for small developers, that sometimes they don't follow the same steps. Sometimes they start for example, the financial feasibility, and then that's when they do the market study, and they do things
that is correct
different ways, and they work sometimes.
That's right. And so Luis brings up a really good point. I mean, I've provided you that diagram, which is a process which is excellent to provide you as a template. But sometimes the real world intervenes, and you need to undertake certain steps and certain tasks because you're required to do so just to make an assessment. But then you've got
to
still go back and do the other kinds of things.
No, I mean, there's,
but if you just did everything hodgepodge, you wouldn't have a framework by which to make decisions.
True.
So better to still have that framework, or else you wouldn't have the ability to guide yourself to a logical and hopefully best use conclusion.
Okay. For example, I used to work for a small developer in Lakeland, Florida, and used to build small multi-families in the Tampa Bay area, and he said he didn't need a market analysis because he knew the area so well that he could determine what
what areas were good for a multifamily.
All right, and so
well, that's
you make raise a good point. And so there are a lot of developers who say, "I don't need this. I know what I'm doing. Chuck it." And they're still small developers. They're still limited to what they know instead of what they could do or what they might know in addition to that. Our goal is not to make you guess this. It's to open the opportunities to be whatever it is that you want to do. And if you still want to be just whatever this is, go for it.
I mean, I think it's really specific to each different thing. Like that may, I mean,
it may work for that gentleman.
In my line of work, sometimes I have to really get into the details for certain subs, and sometimes I don't. Sometimes I have to do, you know, detailed takeoffs for my concrete guys and make sure that they're doing what I want them to do, and sometimes I don't. It doesn't mean that I don't, you know, it just, it really depends on a bunch of factors. I mean, sometimes you can start putting shovels in the ground, you know, with a foundation permit, not have your whole permit, and there's certain risks, but you...
Yeah, you've got to have a template.
So this guy was very soft on the market analysis and a bunch of things, and but he used to do it with everything, not just multifamily. He had retail stores in the Caribbean, affordable housing around the state of Florida. Then I went to work for another developer who was really, you know, detailed with everything. But he didn't have the same returns as this other guy that was just... So I'm just bringing these up
there,
to...
There are lots of ways to do lots of different things. And so what I'm teaching you is a template, a guide. You ultimately will learn how to manage that in the best way that works for you. But if you didn't have that guideline or that template, then where do you start? How do you manage it?
Right.
And the best, the most successful will tailor to what works best ultimately for you. But it's, once again, if somebody doesn't teach you math, and you have a one here and a one there, how do you know how to add them together?
They have an app for that.
By the way, the
app is actually really cool. You take a picture of the mathematical problem, and it solves it and shows you how to do it. It's called PhotoMath.
And
that's really cool.
And
it breaks it down. It's an interesting app.
And
it doesn't work in Part 40s a lot.
No, it doesn't work for complex, but it's kind of interesting how they.
And so if we want to dumb down the world and society, that's great. And so I truly believe that all the wonderful technology and tools that we have are fabulous in the hands of those who are knowledgeable.
That's all right.
But people who don't have that knowledge, the tools are sometimes mostly worthless, and at times just dangerous. And that's part of the larger problem that we have in society, but I don't have time today to tell you about my opinions on that. So that's my list of players. Okay. All right, that's that process, and as I say, and then I'll just summarize this in this one slide. Remember, what is the developer trying to accomplish? And this is going to lead us in, and I'll give us a little break here. This is going to lead us into our discussion on the New York Times. What are we trying to accomplish? And you can remember this for everything. This is really your guiding slide. Who's on the team and what are they able to do and how can they do it? And then what is the way to go about getting that done? All right, so why don't we just take a couple minutes break and then we'll get into the meeting.
Okay.
And I can answer any questions on my red line and my red pen. I have lots of red pens. Yes, and yo, what is it? Oh, integrate financial analysis into the memo.
Okay.
And so,
what do you mean?
Okay.
Again,
it's like,
Oh, yeah, well,
you make him a bunch of assumptions.
Okay. Oh, well, there's another issue.
Well, but you need to provide that.
The garage is something really simple. The front door's not there, that's pretty simple.
Thank goodness this is possible, we can't realize when I have passed 20 people.
But in the garage, there's a hole right next to all the new stuff. I don't mind the other holes in the, by the door.
That's what I thought.
Just because they said it.
But right next to all the new stuff, it's for something you should have.
We're gonna need the blank cover on it.
They go blank?
Need the blank cover on it.
You sure?
Oh, no, no, that's, sorry, that's not the one that drives, that's one here.
All right, but, okay, and, okay.
Okay.
No,
okay, no, I just wanted to know how, what you meant by integrating $5 into that. Meaning what?
I mean, you started to hear, but it's like.
Like more financial analysis.
Yeah, not just more, but this is good, but you kind of appended this, and it's like, all of a sudden, the numbers start showing up here, if this is the. And so, it's like,
okay,
we did this, and here, I performed the analysis, and this shows this, and here's why. I mean, I didn't really get into this. So where did all this come from? Oh yes, well it came from this study, and I'm using this, and you say I don't know why this bank did not do this. I mean,
you're asking
great questions.
Because I wasn't planning to include this. This was just my cheat sheet going through, taking down notes, and I was wondering
but
what one bank didn't
fact,
do
it,
that
but
for.
But in fact, but this makes a great exhibit. It shows how you thought through the deal. And you could have said, and here's our analysis, here's my analysis, the why I came up with these conclusions.
By the way, on the one that I'm going to help you now, I did not include I did include it on the online.
Now I'm going to eat the second half of my bagel for my drink here. See if it's still edible. See what you missed? There was a lively discussion.
Yeah.
And everybody was really focused on.
Not investing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a big risk taker in general, so whenever I see these things,
I'll take my lunch.
And so,
thank you.
I'm not saying that you have to say yes, but
he's a lot for me to say yes. I guess.
Okay, then that's just going to be the nature of how you do your deals and the way you approach things.
And
Wednesday.
And this guy,
yeah, that'd be really good.
Not Wednesday. I planned to do it on Wednesday. Then you call me and say, have you started?
It's safe.
Say, no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not a risk taker.
All right, and so, but there are different levels and different types of risk.
Mm-hmm.
That's okay. And remember, core, value add, opportunistic, different levels of risk there too as well.
Yep.
So there's room for all of that.
Maybe once I start to really grasp the more of the financial side, maybe it'll open my mind a little bit more.
Yeah. What are we presenting for the CRA? Are they coming here or we're going over there to actually present?
I don't know, we haven't figured that out. What would you like it to do?
I don't know.
Go there. I'd like to do it here.
Because
it's our house.
See.
Oh,
I said
Clara,
our
turf, huh?
Yeah, I would.
They're coming into our place, so we'll
yeah, but
where,
you're,
where
you,
the
you gotta go pitch people. So you gotta
we,
go out.
We are gonna pitch
gotta
them,
go
but
out.
They're gonna be in our place,
go to their
and
spot.
We'll pitch them in our place. But if you wanna go to their spot, we can go to their spot.
But so it's interesting. So they're the client.
Yeah, you gotta pitch
the Devo client.
Very interesting.
Nope.
We'll figure it out. So.
We're pro bono.
So the reason why. I like what you did, even though your financials were a little.
Was
because you were concise. You had. You basically took everything and presented it well. And that's important. So there was more there. Your numbers were.
You're trying.
And we'll see where you've got on here.
Yeah, we'll see where
this
is.
Okay. I know you've got other courses that you need to take. That's fine.
And the next month,
and it's part of the challenge is trying to do courses because not everything is sequential, and learning that.
And I put mine up too, because I went from Tuesday, Thursday to Saturdays. I had to change my whole schedule around. So I could graduate within a year versus something longer. So I think I probably threw myself out of sequence there too. But at least I took development one and then development two, and not that.
Basically, built the top of the building, so we had this crane here.
Well, I'm biased. Again, we're doing one and two sequentially. It's fresh. You continue to have concepts.
Yeah, no, we're good doing it in the same semester.
I mean, if I had, if we had more time, I know we have time, maybe I should be giving a problem in the beginning of every class for you to be running through the analysis.
Yeah.
By the way, there's nothing in Russian news, because I watch Russian news every day, because my wife watches them, so I can't force to, but there's nothing in Russian news about protests.
Oh, I know.
About
arresting. I know. They didn't learn anything.
Everything is normal.
That's just crazy to see how they
But
Putin getting on and saying he doesn't really know Rex Tillerson now, and I mean, that just came about last night. I was watching Rachel Maddow saying, you see what he's done? He's like disavowing, and the fact that our State Department now has not even focused on it is so unfortunate. All this, forgive my terminology, this nonsense with Trump, Russia, is obscuring real issues that we should be addressing, and that's bad. We have real issues, but we're ignoring them. We have a State Department that's not doing its job. So, how long have you been in this country?
I ran the numbers.
How many?
15.
Wait, how long?
I was 15. I was 16.
Really? So